Woke. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Y'all, we back at it. Just want to say thanks for y'all still rocking with me on this storytelling album. But today we're going to get into something that's real, real, real personal to me. I want to get into this thing called regret. And I want to talk about patience. I'm going to combine the two, man, and give y'all a story, man, that hit near and dear, close to home. I want to talk about my little homeboy, YG HOODRU. Real young homie. Now see, back in the 90s, man, we was banging and tearing shit up in North New Jersey. And, you know, we had a couple of solid homies from the hood, man. And at this particular place, you know, we used to meet at their crib in North North, right on Broadway. So, you know, on any given day, man, you looking at 20, 25, 30 knuckleheads in there having a meeting. And, every time we would meet, man, the little homie Hood, man, at that time, he was a little young little nigga, man. I'm talking about maybe, shit, 12, 13 years old, little young nigga. He always tried to sneak out that back room, man, just to be nosy, man. The homie always wanted to be involved, man. He used to kick the little nigga up his ass, tell him get out of here, man, like he wanted to be a part of. So from day one, man, he was already exposed to the shit that was going on in the city of North. Shit was right in his house, right in his living room. He wanted everything that the hood had to offer. Little nigga ain't really care, man. He was with all that. So I wanna fast forward a couple of years, man. You know, when the homie officially got put on the hood, man. I mean, the hood embraced him, took him, man. And the homie proved himself from day one, man. And nobody ever had no questions about hood, man. Hood was a rider, man. Hood was one of them backseat niggas, man. You know, da-da-da-ow. Yeah, that was hood. So, 2008, you know, my book, Water Bloods, came out, and you know, it was a real big thing where I was from. I mean, shit, niggas ain't really never did nothing where I was from, especially in my hood, you know. Niggas is good for killings and shootings and robberies and going to jail and ducking child support, you know, shit like that. So for somebody to do something more on a constructive basis or a more positive level, man, that shit was really a big thing, man. And that book that I wrote, man, really motivated and inspired a lot of niggas, man. So fast forward one more year, 2009, I was actually nominated for the best memoir in New York, the African-American Literary Awards. Real big thing to me, man. I mean, you know, they actually nominated me and my story as one of the best books out at that time. Couldn't really tell me nothing, man. I mean, I just felt like, you know, I had done something that was useful. So, you know, we planning and making preparation to go to New York for this event. And mind you, at the same time, they asked me to give an award to J.M. Benjamin, who, you know, one of the good bros from Plainfield. I had to, you know what I'm saying, actually present an award to him. So I was it was needed for me to be there at 5:30, 6 o'clock p.m. Yup, September 25th of 2009. So all day we had been planning and preparing to get out there. You know, I had my list who was going, me, my moms, my aunt, my sister Jada, my homeboy Jay. You know, it was a good group of us that was going. And Hood was supposed to be there and my homeboy P. I was actually gonna go to North North to scoop them before we got on the road to head to New York, right? So I hit the homies and told them I'd be there at 4 o'clock because, you know, I wanted to give myself about an hour, hour and a half to get on the road, get through that New York traffic, get through the tunnels, get parking, and get situated before I get in there and present this award. So as I leave the crib, I'm headed over to North North to pick the homies up, and I get there at the exact time that I said I would be there, 4 p.m. I text the homie and tell him on my side, come on out, we gotta go. I got my moms in the truck, got my sister in the truck. I mean, you know, we going deep now. The homie texts my phone back. I'm talking about YG HOODRU. Whoa. The homie texts my phone back and was like, hey, big bro, man, I had to dip off, I'm like 20, 25 minutes away. Can you wait for me? Now he with P at the time, and he texted me telling me he damn near 30 minutes away. My whole day done been calculated and mapped out, you know what I'm saying? And so immediately I flipped. Immediately I flip. I mean, everybody know me, they know how I am for time. I'm anal as hell when it come to time. I'm always on time, everything gotta be done in order, done on time, cross all T's, dot all I's. So I'm furious in this car right now that he done allowed me to drive from the West Side District of North, the Hooter, all the way over to North North to pick them up, and they know damn well they wasn't there. So what did I do? We left, pulled off, man, and we got on that road, man. We headed to New York. I was so angry the whole time, the whole ride over there, because I was so pissed. We went to New York. So we get to New York, man. The day was successful. I presented the award. I won my award. It was a great night. We was drinking champagne, drinking wine. I mean, the good kind too, man. We just had a good night. Everything was just perfect. It was just perfect. So after we left the award show, we all went out to dinner to some fancy restaurant in the city. Ordered all the good food, all the good wine, drinks, champagne, all that good shit, man. We celebrated. Niggas from North done actually did something, right? So we get back to Jersey, back to North around like 11:30, 12 o'clock at night. And at this point, I'm pretty whacked out my mind right now. And I mean, I done been drinking a lot of good shit. So, you know, I really ain't had no more, nothing for nobody. I just wanted to lay down, close my eyes. So I'm in my homeboy crib on Mount Prospect. I doze off, man. I'm asleep, man. About 3 a.m., man, I'm waking up. I woke up to my phone ringing. I pick up the phone, man. I'm looking at my phone. I got 30 missed calls. No bullshitting. Literally. 30 missed phone calls. Heart drop. I already knew something done happened. I knew somebody done died. I knew something bad happened. That wasn't my first time getting those type phone calls in the middle of the night. And I dreaded making a phone call back. Only thing was going through my mind at the time was, who? Where? And why? So I pick up the phone and I dial a number back to the little homie that had called me all them times. And soon as he pick up the phone, man, I can hear the homie sobbing and crying and weeping, and I mean, and all the homie kept saying to me was, we lost him. We lost him. So I'm like, who? Lost who? Blood said hood, man. He told me that hood killed himself that night. My little nigga. I swear I thought I was in a fucking nightmare, man. I mean, that wasn't the first time I done woke up from a nightmare. Happy as hell that I woke up. And I knew any moment I was just gonna pop up. This shit wasn't real. See, this little nigga hood looked up to me so much, man. It was ridiculous, man. I mean, this nigga, I don't wanna say worship me, but the nigga really looked up to me. Even before I get into what happened that night, just rewind 1 year back in 2008 when the book came out. We had a nice little book release party. I swear you would've thought Hood wrote that fucking book, man. That's how proud that nigga was, man. That nigga walked around that little hall that we rented out, and you just swore that he wrote that book, man. He was so proud of a nigga, man. Like, it's, that shit meant something to my city, man. That shit meant something to my niggas, man. So when the homie explaining to me what happened, he telling me that Hood killed himself that night, man, in his apartment. Nigga shot himself in the head. This is what they telling me. Now, what y'all don't know about Hood, man, was Hood was a stressed out little nigga, man. Hood was depressed. Hood had a lot of issues going on, man. Hood, home life wasn't the best, man. His foundation wasn't solid, man. He had an older sister. You know what I'm saying? Salute to my sis, Shalina, man. She was holding shit down in that house, man. taking care of him, taking care of the family, little siblings. Hood was running the street. So Hood didn't always have it. I mean, if you actually knew him, you could see it in his eyes, man. Bro didn't have it all there. And see, when you know something about niggas like that, man, you know that they feed, they thrive off of good shit. They thrive off of, you know, good opportunities coming to niggas that's close to them, man. Because a lot of times they don't get them fucking opportunities. So they enjoying life through you, man. And I was that nigga. I was that nigga where I'm from. So yeah, they tell me my homeboy dead, man. From that moment forward, man, I always took his death and I wore it on my back, man. I always said that I regret not being patient enough. I kick myself to this day wondering, like, why the fuck I just ain't wait for my nigga, dawg? Fuck that award, man. That shit wasn't worth my homie life. So I done been through some severe counseling, man. Some severe therapy over this shit, man. And it seemed like they always tell me, man, I can't wear that death on my shoulders. That ain't my fault. They feed me with all that clinical shit. That generic shit that everybody gonna tell you. But let's put all that bullshit to the side, man. Let's get down to the fucking facts of the matter. You're not gonna tell me that my being impatient that night had no bearings on what the fuck happened that night. See, it's easy to tell me that it wasn't my fault, but I feel like the night that we had that night, if my homie was there, had I been a little more patient and dog would have been there, man, I know that shit would have brought some joy to that nigga life, man. The night was fucking beautiful, man. Like, we had an actual beautiful night, man. Everything was just like perfect. That shit, who knows, man, that shit could have been everything to get that nigga a little spark, man. We need that shit in the hood, man. Y'all don't know shit about them sparks, man. That shit get you through the next week, the next month. That shit matters. I can't say what the fuck would have happened with Hood down the line, but I know that night, my nigga wouldn't have killed himself. I can't speak for the week later, a month later, but that blood wouldn't have been on my motherfucking hands. That's just like you out there trapping and clocking and shit, and the fucking fiend come through the block and shit, and you serve him, and they OD on your motherfucking product, man. That blood on your motherfucking hand. But then you gonna have a nigga who out here trapping sandwich, hey, fuck it, man. If I ain't serving shit, went down a block, got served by somebody else. Yeah, motherfucker, but the blood wouldn't have been on your hands, though. I just wish I'd have been a little more patient that fucking night and waited for my nigga, man. And I know you hear me, bro. I know you hear me. People tell me all the time, man, you're in a better place and all this. Man, how the fuck? You don't even know my nigga. You don't know where that nigga at. Shit, I don't know where he at. But I know when I left that nigga, man. Trying to think what that nigga was thinking, like, damn, bro, them fucking left me and shit. Hey, Hood, I know you hear me though, bro. Hey, I know you know where the fuck my heart is at, bro. I got personal shit I'm working and dealing with, man. And that's something I'm trying to grow from and grow through, man. Being impatient. Wherever the fuck you at, bro, know your nigga love you, homie. Boom to the tune, blood. I'm still out here rocking with your family, man. I know you see it. I ain't never gonna take this one laying down, man. Never. All that forgive yourself, and I don't wanna fucking forgive myself. I don't want to. Cause I fucked up. I love you, little homie. I'ma keep rocking and repping and holding you up. Hard body. And I hope you proud of a nigga. I hope you proud of a nigga. I've been been working on that patient thing though, homie. I've been working on it. I ain't mastered the art of that shit yet, cause the nigga's still hot-headed. But ever since that night, bro, I try not to rush things so much. I try not to take it so serious, man. Everything ain't gotta be at the... It ain't gotta be that, man. I love you, blood. Big homie said that. Whoa, whoa.